The subject is programming in Java and the code is CA582. This subject is taught in MCA third semester. So today we will discuss these topics. What are Java access specifiers? What are static class members, whether they are variables or methods? Final keyword, the nested classes, including inner classes, the concepts of inheritance, and the concepts of packages and interfaces. So first we will start with the Java access specifiers. Now in case of Java, we have three access specifiers. First one is protected, then public, and then private. So protected access specifier is applied only in case of inheritance. So we will use this protected access specifier and discuss this in detail when we will do inheritance. Now next one is public. Now the class data of a method that is visible to any class in any package and can be accessed from the code outside the class, that is our public access specifier. That means if we are declaring a class or a variable or a method as public, then that can be accessed from anywhere outside the class. Now next one is the private access specifier. Now the data on methods that can be accessed only by the other member of its class. So this is the property of the private data members or the methods that it cannot be accessed outside the class. Now by default, when we are not using any access specifier, then the class is public within its own package but cannot be accessed outside of its class. So that is the important point. Now next is, what are static class members? Now every member has its own copy of all the instance variables of the class. See, when we are declaring the instance and when we are allocating the memory to a object of the class, in that case it creates its own copy. So if any changes are made in that object variables, then that will be visible to that object only, so that they are not visible to the other objects. So if we want that a single copy is shared by all the members, then we have to declare that member variable or the class members as static. So if one copy of an instance variable is to be shared by all the objects, then that variable should be declared as static. Now a static variable automatically initializes to zero and is known as the class variable. To distinguish it from a member or instance variable which is not shared. So if we have used the keyword static with any variable, then that will be automatically initialized to zero. Now the static class variables and methods exist and can be used even if no objects of that class have been instantiated. See, when we are creating an object, through that object we can access the member variables and the method of that class. So if we do not want to create an instance and we want to call those methods or variables without creating the object of that class, then we have to declare those methods and variables as static. So we have the static variables as well as the static methods. Now static variable, it is a single variable that is accessible from any instance of the class. So we can directly access the static members without instantiating the instance of that class. Static method cannot access any variable other than the local variables, static attributes and its parameters. So that is the property of a static method, that it cannot access any variable other than the local variables or the static attributes and its parameters. For example, we always say that everything in Java is inside the class. So our main method is also defined inside the class. But our execution of the program starts from the main function, and when the main function is called, main method is called, at that point no object of any class has been instantiated. So that's why we declare main method as static, because we want that this should be called first of all without any instantiation of the object. So that is an example. So we declare main method as static because the JVM does not create an instance of the class when executing the main method. So that is the first method that is to be called. Now some important points are there for the static variables and method. Now the static members are not tied to any particular instance of a class. So they can be called directly without the instance of the class. So no class instances are needed in order to use static members of the class. There is only one copy of a static variable and all instances share that copy. So static members do not have direct access to non-static members. So that is the restriction for the static members. Now I will show you a program in that we have used the static method. As you can see here, so as you can see here, there is a class a student, and it has one member, that is the roll number, and one member we have declared it as static. So count is a static member and it is of integer type. Now in case of the constructor, before the constructor we are incrementing the count, and one method is there, that is roll number, and we are passing a value of I, and that roll number has been initialized. Now we have also created a method as static one. So in this, as we have, I have already told you that a static member method can access only the static members and the local variables. So in this we are printing the value of count. So now another method is there, that is the display roll number, and it will display the roll number. Now another class, in this we have declared a in the main method we have created the object, but before creating the object S1 we have called the static method of this class. How to call the static method of class? You have to write the class name and then dot and the name of the static method. Now this display count will show zero, because I have already told you that static variables are initialized to zero when they are declared. So initially in count we have only zero. Now when we are creating an S1, an object of type student, in that case default constructor is called, so count is incremented by 1. So first time when this statement is executed, count is zero. Then when this statement is executed, count is 1. Now S2, we have created another object, that is S2, and in that case it will become 2. Now when we are displaying S1 dot display count, it will display 2 because it is having 2. So count is a static variable, and it, the copy of the static variable is shared by all the instances. So when we are calling S1 dot display count, it will show you 2. Then S1 dot roll number. Now in this particular case, when we are doing this one, S1 has its own memory, S2 has its own memory, and the count has been allocated some another memory, and S1 and S2 both are sharing this copy. So currently we have 2. Now when we are displaying S1, when we are calling roll number from method S1 dot roll number, then in case of S1, in roll number it will be 10. Then we are displaying S1 dot display roll number, it will display 10 on the execution of this statement. S2 dot display count. Now S2 is accessing this count, so S2 will display 2. So because it is shared by, this is a static variable and it is shared by count, it is 2. So this is the copy that is shared by all the members. So this is the concept of static members and static methods and static variables. So we have discussed about static variables and methods. Now next topic is final keyword. So final is a keyword. Now if a variable is declared as final, it cannot be modified. So once the value has been set in a final variable, the variable that is declared as final, then it cannot be modified. Now this final keyword is same as we have already used in C and C++. In case of C and C++, we were using const keyword. C-O-N-S-T, const keyword we are using, and it has the same meaning as that of the const keyword. So it does not occupy memory on a per instance basis. For example, how to declare a final variable, you have to use the keyword final, then the data type of the variable, then the name of the variable equal to its value. Now A will always have value 20. You cannot change the value of A because it has been declared as final. So that is the concept of final. When we will do inheritance, we will discuss the final class. Now next is nested classes. Now a class defined inside another class, such classes are known as nested classes. When a class is nested inside another class, it can access the members, including private members of the class in which it is nested, but enclosing class does not have access to the members of the nested class. Now according to this rule, once you have declared a class inside a class, then the container class cannot access the members of the insider class. Now there are different types of nested classes. First one is the static and another one is non-static nested classes. Now what are static classes? A static nested class is one which has a static modifier applied to it. It must access the members of its enclosing class through an object. Now non-static classes, an inner class is a non-static class. That is an example of non-static class. It has access to all the variables and methods of its outer class and may refer to them directly in the same way that other non-static members of the class, outer class, do. So an inner class is fully within the scope of its enclosing class. So I will show you an example. As you can see here, so we have created a class out, in that a variable A has been declared and one variable B has been declared as private and one variable C has been declared as final. Now next is the default constructor, in that we are initializing ABC variables. Then we have the outer data method. Inside the outer data method, we have declared a class in. See, this is a nested class because we are declaring, we are defining the class inside a function that is enclosed within a class. So in is the inner class and out is the container class. Now in class, we have declared a variable in. The default constructor, we are initializing I to 1, then display. In display method, we are accessing the variables of the container class, that is the ABC and I. Now outside this method, we are creating an instance of in class and we are calling c1.display, right? So it will call this display method. Now see, there are two methods. One is the display, that is of the in class, and another display method is there, that is the of the out class. So it is display. displaying the values of ABC. This display method is the method of the out class, and this display method is the method of in class, and it is displaying the value of I. As we have already discussed, the inner class can access the data members of a container class, but a container class cannot access the data members of the inner class. So in this we have created the object of out class, and through the object of out class we are calling oval.outdata, and then we are calling oval.displayData. Now when we are calling this display, first of all, because we have created an instance of this class, so it will call this method display method, and this oval.display will call the method of the container class. So this is an example of nested classes. Now next we will start with the concept of inheritance. Now what is inheritance? Now it is a relationship between the parent and child, and we the classes can act as a parent, another class can act as a child. Now it allows sharing of the behavior of parent class into its child classes. So one of the major benefits of object oriented programming is this code sharing between classes through inheritance. Now the child class can add new behavior or override existing behavior from parent. So child class has the capability of including new members and methods into the inheritance. Now there are some terms that we will use, so we will discuss those terms. First is superclass, or we can say the base class or parent class. So these three terms can be used for the parent class. These are the terms to describe the parent in the relationship which share its functionality or class that is inherited. So that is the base class. We can call it a base class or super class or the parent class. Now the second term, the type of term that we will use is subclass, derived class or child class. So these are terms to describe the child in the relationship which accepts functionality from its parent, or that inherits all the instance variables and methods and adds its unique element. Now the keywords that we will use is extend. The terms that we will use is extend, inherit or derive. Now they are having the same meaning, that means it will become a subclass of another class. So these are the terms that we will use in inheritance. Now in Java you can specify another class as your parent by using the keyword extends. Suppose any class wants to use the behavior, or you can say the members and methods of another class, then it can use the keyword extends. For example, how to write that? First you have to write the class keyword, then we have to write the subclass. Now the subclass is the class that wants to inherit the properties of superclass. So we will define the subclass, then we will use the extends keyword, and then the name of the superclass. And then we have to write the designation of the subclass. That means that this subclass is inheriting the properties of this superclass. So the objects of your class will now receive all of the state and behavior, or you can say the members and methods of the parent class. Constructors and static methods are not inherited. So these things we have to keep in mind, that the constructors and static methods cannot be inherited. By default, a class parent is the object class. Now there is a default class, that is the object class, that is the parent of, by default that is the parent of all the classes that are inbuilt or that we will create. Now some points to be noted are, Java forces a class to have exactly one parent. So in case of Java, only single inheritance is possible. Whereas in case of C++, that is object-oriented programming language, it allows multiple inheritance. So that we have to keep in mind, that in case of Java, only single inheritance is possible. Now a subclass can become a superclass of another class. So when we are saying that sentence, that means in this particular case A is the superclass and B is the subclass of A. Now B has become the superclass of C because C is inheriting the properties of B and B is inheriting the properties of C. So indirectly C is inheriting the properties of A. So that is the single inheritance. So no class can be a superclass of itself. So you have to keep in mind that no class can be a superclass of itself. I will show you in a program. So this is an example of inheritance. So we have imported the java.util package because we are using the scanner class. The scanner class is used for taking the input from the user. We have a parent class. In that parent class we are defining the string of father's name. Pan number is private, and then we have created an object of scanner class. Now there is a method, that is parent get data, that is used for taking the data from the user. So the parents data we can take. So we are using sc.next line for taking the father's name, sc.next in for taking pan number. Now another method is there in this parent class, that is the parent display data. It will display the information of the parent data, that is the pan number. Then there is a subclass. This is the name of the subclass. It is extending the parent class. So that means this subclass is inheriting the properties of parent class. Now in this subclass we have the name. So sub get data method is used for taking the data name of the child. Then sub display data is used for displaying the name of the child, father's name, and the pan number cannot be displayed because that is a private. So the private data members of a superclass cannot be inherited. So you have to keep in mind. Now, in case of main method, we are creating an object of subclass, and then we are calling the methods of superclass. That means, with the object of subclass, we are calling the method of superclass. That is s1.parent_get_data. Now it will take the father's name and pan number. Then we are calling s1.sub_get_data. We are taking the input for the subclass, and then we are displaying the data of subclass, sub display data. In this, it will display the father's name and child's name, and then we are calling s1.parent display data. So it will display the pan number also. So you can see here in comments that I have created a reference variable of the superclass, that is P is the reference variable of the superclass, and we are assigning the object of subclass to P. So P is getting the reference of S1 and we are calling P dot parent display data. So a superclass variable can reference a subclass variable, and we can if we are writing P dot sub display data, now this is the method of subclass. So this reference variable of type parent class cannot access the data of subclass, so it will show a compilation error. So this is the example of your inheritance. So as you can see here, this is the inheritance hierarchy. So deeper layer chain of classes, many children extending many layers of J component class is the subclass of container class. Then these classes are inheriting the properties of J component. So indirectly they are inheriting the properties of container component as well as object class. So and then we can see here that J menu item class is inheriting the property of J abstract button, and then these three classes are inheriting the properties of J menu item. So indirectly we can say that these three classes are inheriting the properties of this and the object class. So this is in hierarchy of inheritance. Now there are two types of relationships. One is has a relationship, another one is a relationship. So what is a has a relationship? When one object contains another as field, so that is called a has a relationship. For example, we have the bank account manager class, and inside the class we have taken a variable my account that is of type list. So list is class that is the inbuilt class. So bank account manager has a list of has a my accounts variable of type list. So this is a has a relationship. Now next one is a relationship. Now is a relationships represent sets of abilities implemented through interfaces and inheritance. As we can see here, public, there is a checking account class that is public. It is extending bank account class. So checking account object is a bank account, therefore it can do anything on bank account can do. So because this checking account class is inheriting the bank account class, so it can access the members and methods of bank account class. So therefore it can do anything on bank account do. It can be substituted wherever a bank account is needed. A variable of type bank account may refer to a checking account object. So that is an example of is a relationship. So some points to be noted here are: a superclass variable can reference a subclass object. A reference variable of a superclass can be assigned a reference to any subclass derived from that superclass, as I have already told you in the example. Using superclass reference, we can access only the parts of the object that are part of superclass. So this is an important point. Therefore, the superclass has no knowledge of what a subclass added to it. So this you have to keep in mind, that a subclass knows what the superclass has, but a superclass do not have any idea what the subclass has added to its functionalities. Now one more point that is to be keep in mind, what should be the hierarchy of constructors. A constructor in the extended class can directly invoke one of the superclass constructors using explicit constructor invocation. If superclass constructor is not invoked, then the superclass no argument constructor is automatically invoked before any statement of the new constructor are executed. That is the super constructor. Now, by these points, we will know that if this is the hierarchy. So C is the subclass of B, B is the subclass of A, and when we are creating an object of class C, and in that case, first of all, the constructor of A will be called and B will be called, and then the constructor of C will be called automatically. Now, this is again we are discussing the hierarchy of constructor. Constructor order dependencies: when an order object is created, memory is allocated for all its fields. After this, superclass constructor is invoked, fields are initialized, and the body of the constructor is executed. I will show you a program for this. So this is the hierarchy of constructors. Class A is the superclass of B because B is extending A. Then C is extending B. So indirectly, C is inheriting the properties of A. So when we are calling the object C1, so first it will call, it will go to this, and then this will be executed, and then this will be executed. So first of all, the constructor of A will be invoked, and then B, and then C. So that is the example of how the constructors are invoked. So as I have already told you that if superclass constructor is not invoked, then superclass no argument constructor is automatically invoked before any statement of the new constructor are executed. That is, the super constructor will be executed. Now next very important concept is method override. Now when a child class can replace the behavior of its parent's method by redefining them, that is called the method overriding. The method of subclass overrides the method of superclass if both have same name and same parameter list. If method of subclass and superclass has same name but different parameters, then no overriding takes place. See, we have already done the concept of method overloading. In case of method overloading, when a class has the same name methods but their parameter list is different, that is called method overloading. Method overriding can occur in case of inheritance only, where a subclass is inheriting the properties of superclass and both are having the same name method with similar type of data inside it that we are passing. So that is the, then when we are creating the object of subclass, then which method will be called, either the subclass method or the superclass method, so that we have to see. So it is super keyword has its own significance. It is used to refer to superclass of current class. It can be used to refer to parent class methods, variable, constructors call them. It is needed when there is a name conflict with current class. See, when suppose the display method is defined in superclass as well as it is also defined in subclass. So when we are creating the instance of subclass and we are calling this display method, in that case, because the constructor, the object is of type subclass, so it will call the display method of subclass, right? So when we want to call the superclass display method with the help of the instance of subclass, then we can use the super keyword. So it is useful when overriding and you want to keep the old behavior but add new behavior to it. So this is the syntax how we can use the super keyword when we are declaring, when we are defining the constructor of the super class. We can use the super keyword and we can pass the set of arguments. We can also call the access the member variables of the super class by using super dot name of the super class member variables. We can also call the method of super class by using super dot then the method name and the arguments. So there is another program for this. So it differentiates, it is used to super to differentiate the superclass and the subclass data members and method overriding. As you can see here, this is class A, it is having the variable I and display method is there, then value method is there and we are passing I. So this dot I, this is referring to the current object. Then we are displaying the value of I. Then another class is there, that is the B class, it is extending A. Now again B is having the same name variable I, right? So I variable is there in the class A also and I variable is there in the B class also. And in the constructor we are initializing the, now we have written two statements, one is super dot I, one is I. Now when we are writing I is equal to A, that means it is referring to the this I, the I of B class, that is the subclass. When we want to access the superclass variable of same name, then we have to use super keyword. That's why we are adding super dot I. Now it is referring to the I are incrementing it by 10. So this, there is a difference between this I and super dot I. Then display method is again there, and we are using I, we are displaying I, and then we are calling the display method of super class. So how to call the super class display method? Super dot display. So in the same, we are now in case of class A, we are having a value method, but it has only one argument. So, and in class B, we have value method, the same, name is same, but in this we are passing two variables. So, it this is not method overriding. In case of display method, it is over, method overriding, because they have the same name and the argument list is same, because both are void. So, this is not overridden. So, this is the case. And again we are calling, we are using super dot I for referring to the super class I variable, and I, this I is referring to the subclass variable, and then we are creating an object of B class, subclass, and we are passing 10. When we are passing 10 to this constructor, that means this will be called, and we have passed 10. So A is 10. So 10 plus 10 is 20. So now super and subclass I. Super class I is having value 20 and this is having value 10. Right? Then we are displaying B dot display. So it will call the subclass display method and it will print this value, as we can see here, super dot I. So it is displaying super dot I, so it will display 20, and when I will be displayed, it will display 10, and then it is calling super dot display. So super dot display will call the super class display method. In superclass display method, it is displaying I. So again, it will display the I, value of I of the superclass. So that will be the output of this method when we call this statement. This one. This one. Right? Then, again, we are passing 10 in the value method. Now B dot value 10 means we are passing 10 in the subclass B, this value method. So as this is not method overriding, as you can see here, we are passing only one argument. So it will call the value method of superclass, this one. So it is displaying this dot I is equal to I. So we have passed 10. Have we passed 10 or 20? We have passed 10, B dot value. So it is calling this one. So now the super class I will have 10, right? So the value has been updated, and then it is printing the value of I. So it will print 10 now. Now again, it is passing B dot value 20 and 30. So now we are passing two arguments in the value method. So it will call the subclass value function method. So I will have 20 and j will have 30. So super dot I is equal to I. That means super will have 20 and I is equal to j. That means it will have 30. So it will play it will display this value. Super dot I. So it will display now 20 and the value of I will be displayed as 30. So that is the case. So that will be the output of this program. And when we are creating an object of class A, that is a super class, and we are calling A1 dot display, in that case super class display method will be called. So that is an example of method overriding. Now, if the superclass has a constructor that requires any arguments, you must put a constructor in the subclass and have it call the super constructor. Now, I will show you an example in which super keyword is used for constructors. So, how to call a superclass constructor? So now as you can see here, ELP is the class and it is having name and SSN number. ELP, this is the default constructor and we are initializing name and SSN. Then this is the parameterized constructor and we are initializing the name and SSN of this class. Then we have a class salary that is extending the EMP class, and in this we are having BS and COMM, and then we are initializing these variables inside the salary constructor, and this is the parameterized constructor. As you can see here, in case of parameterized constructor, we are passing four values. So two values are used for initializing the variables of salary class, and two variables are used for initializing the variables of super class. So we are calling the super class constructor by using super keyword super, and then we are passing the arguments that we want to pass, and then we are initializing the member variables of subclass. Then it is having the display method and we are displaying the all the variables. As you can see here, when we are creating an object of this salary S1, so this default constructor is called. So in that case, what will happen? The default constructor is called and BS will have 100. So we will make a S1. BS is having 100 and COMM is having 10. Right? So in S1 we have this, and default constructor of EMP will be called. As we already discussed the hierarchy, how the constructors are initialized. So it will have name. Name will be equal to alpha, and SSN will be having value 111. So that will be the values for S1. And then the second statement, S1 dot display. So when S1 dot display will be executed, it will display for name it will display alpha, for SSN it will display 111, and for BS it will display 100, and for COM it will display 10. Now again, if when we are creating an object of S2, in that case we are accessing the parameterized constructor. So we are passing ABC 123, 10,000 and 1,000. So now this parameterized constructor of the subclass will be called. As you can see here, in the parameterized constructor, first statement is the super n comma s. That means these two values will be passed to the super class constructor, parameterized constructor, and this is the parameterized constructor. So name will have ABC1 and your SSN will have value 123. Now it will come again to the parameterized constructor of the subclass, and BS will have B, that means BS is equal to 10,000 and your COM is equal to 1,000. So that these will be the values in instance S2. And when we will display this statement, it will show these values. So this is how a super keyword is used for calling the super class constructor. Now next one is super keyword that we have already done. super keyword and the constructor. Now next method is dynamic method dispatch. Now it is also known as runtime polymorphism, as it is a mechanism by which a call to an overridden method is resolved at runtime rather than compile time. Now in the last example, when we are calling a overridden method at the compile time, it is known that when we are using the object of subclass, the subclass overridden method will be called, not the superclass. So to resolve this problem at runtime, we use the concept of dynamic method dispatch. Now runtime polymorphism is achieved with dynamic method dispatch. A superclass reference variable can refer to a subclass object. Now when an overridden method is called through a superclass reference, Java determines which version of that method to execute based upon the type of the object being referred to at the time the call occurs. So thus the determination is made at runtime. So it is the type of the object being referred to that determines which version of an overridden method will be executed. I will show you an example. So this is an example of dynamic method dispatch. We have a class superclass and it is having S1 as its member variable, and we have declared it, initialized it to 10. Then superclass, we are incrementing S1 by 1. Then display method is there and we are displaying the S1 value. Then there is a subclass that is extending the superclass and it is having variable S2. Now S2 is incremented, then we are displaying the value of S2. Now subclass 1 is again extending the subclass, so there is a hierarchy. First is the superclass and then we have the subclass and then we have the subclass 1. So this is the hierarchy. So it is having the S3 variable and we are displaying the value of S3. Now we have a class DMD. In that we have declared a very defined the main method, and we have created the superclass variable S11. Now we are using S11.display. So subclass version is called in this case subclass method is called now S1S, because as you can see here, we have created a declared a variable of a superclass, but we are initializing it with the constructor of subclass. So it is having the subclass value, so it will display the display method of subclass. Now in S11, now we are passing the reference of subclass 1, that is the third class. Then it will display the value of S3. Now we are passing the reference of the superclass, so it will display the value of S1. So what will it will display? First the value of S3 will be displayed, sorry, S2 will be displayed, then the value of S3 will be displayed, and then the value of S1 will be displayed. So this is the concept how dynamic method dispatch occurs, or the runtime polymorphism occurs. So the point that is to be noted about the dynamic method dispatch: when an overridden method is called through a superclass reference, Java determines which version of that method to execute based upon the type of the object being referred to at the time the call occurs, that I have already shown you. Now, a point that is to be noted about overridden methods. Overridden methods provide greater flexibility to subclasses. Therefore, by combining inheritance with overridden methods, a superclass can define the general form of the methods that will be used by all of its subclasses. Now next concept is of the abstract classes. Sometimes the superclass only defines the general structure of the methods that is to be shared by all of its subclasses. But the implementation details varies from subclass to subclass. So this can be resolved by declaring that method as abstract. So therefore, it is a subclass responsibility to define the implementation details of that method. So the superclass will only tell you the name and the parameters that you want to pass, but the definition is missing in the abstract class. Now it is the responsibility of the subclass that is inheriting the abstract class that it has to provide the definition to that method. So if any class contains one or more than one abstract methods, that class should be declared as abstract. There can be no object of an abstract class. Abstract constructors or abstract static methods cannot be declared. So you have to keep in mind that you cannot declare a constructor or a static method as abstract. Any subclass of an abstract class must either implement all of the abstract methods in the superclass or be itself declared abstract. So there is a note for the abstract classes. The abstract classes cannot be used to instantiate objects, but they can be used to create object references. Therefore, Java's runtime polymorphism is implemented through the use of superclass reference. Now, we have already done the final keyword, but we will elaborate it for the methods also. A member variable declared final cannot be modified, so we cannot change the value of the variable that is declared as final. A method declared final cannot be overridden. So once you have declared a method final, so that cannot be overridden. No subclass can override that method. So a class declared as final cannot be inherited, and all the methods are final by default. An abstract class cannot be made final as it is incomplete in itself. So these points have to keep in mind. So in the next lecture, we will discuss about packages and interfaces.